Once a sinner far from Jesus, I was perishing to go. And I heard my blessed Savior, heard my cry. And he threw his arms around me, and he led me to his home. I'm living on my hallelujah side. Oh, glory be Jesus, let that hallelujah go. Let me ring my
seated. Well, I'm looking out here and I'm seeing some good-looking people here this morning. Who am I talking to? I'm talking to all of you. You're all looking good here this morning. It is good to be in the house of God in the nice warm temperatures. Hey, it's actually fairly nice outside right now. We don't have the 2 degrees, 3 degrees that we had earlier this week. How many enjoyed that? Really? Really? Not me. Anyway. Good. There's probably more that did not enjoy it than did. Okay. All right. We're not going to take up. Anyway, good to see you guys here this morning. It is a different morning, but it is the day that the Lord has made. Amen. Okay. And whatever we are faced with, whatever obstacles or situations we've been talking about, adversity in Sunday school, whatever situations you're dealing with, you know what? God is in control of everything. God is in charge. Okay. So we can put our trust in other things, and other things will fail. Other things will let us down. But if we put our faith and our trust in the one who's in control of it all, we've got this. All right. Greetings, and I'm going by my piece of paper that I'm supposed to follow, and I don't have the pastor hat on or the mom hat on, because mom's, or pastor and sister pastor, mom and dad. Anyway, I don't have their hats on this morning, but I am doing their jobs, I guess. I'll try. It is good to see you guys. So I'm going to do a few little greetings and a few little announcements. With mom and dad not here this morning because they're not feeling very well, there is not going to be a service tonight. Okay, so our normal Sunday night service is canceled. Same thing with also this upcoming CFI on Thursday night. It is also canceled. So Wednesday nights, still going. Kids and youth ministry, they're still going to be up and going. And so Again, thank you guys for those that are out there participating in the children's and youth ministry on Wednesday nights and being out there for those kids, okay, and being there to help them. So thank you. Hello online. Thank you for viewing us online. And those that are out there on Wednesday nights and coming out, thank you guys for doing that. So birthdays and anniversaries. Did anybody get older this past week? Did anybody have another year of a wonderful relationship with their significant other? Nobody got older? No anniversaries? T-Bone can't sell some pens? He says, I'm fine with that. All right. Well, if nobody, we all did get older, right? It was another day older. Some of us may have felt it, especially on those really cold mornings. We feel a lot older on those mornings. At least I do. All right. We've got some prayer requests that that we need to mention and talk about. We're going to go to Lord in prayer here in just a second. I've asked Brother Kenny ahead of time, way ahead of time, like as I was getting up from the drums, I asked him. So he's had plenty of opportunity. But we got some things we need to pray about in this church. First of all, there's sickness going around. Okay, there's a lot of people who are under the weather. They're not feeling well, whether it's they've got a head issue, a sickness in the head or in the respiratory or in the nose and the entire body and all these different things. We just need God's hand upon each and every one of those. Those that have gone through some things and problems that they've dealt with and been in the hospitals and coming out of it, we just need God to continue praying for them. Yes, we've got the list up on the screen behind us. I've got the list here in front of me, and my glasses are over there. So the list is a little blurry. And that happens with age too. But anyway, let's remember these needs in our prayers, okay? Let's remember our pastors, okay? They, I know mom and dad. They want to be here, okay? And it takes a little bit to keep them down. So we just ask that God keep his hand upon them, keep them healthy and safe. Pray for our country. Our country needs prayer, okay? Our leaders need prayer. There's a lot of issues that that are ongoing out there, whether it's here on our shores or whether it's thousands of miles away that are brewing, okay? We need God's hand in all these different situations. For our men and women that are in the service, those that are out there protecting, God keep his hand upon them. Our law enforcement officers, those in EMS and medical professions, God keep his hand upon them. Keep them safe. Keep them healthy. Keep this church lifted up. Okay, that we will help each other when dealing with times, and that's when I'll use the old saying, that's when we see what we're really made of. Okay, when others are able to step up. We appreciate Brother and Sister McGee stepping up and coming this morning and preaching. Had to rearrange some schedules, I'm sure, to get here, but we appreciate them for doing that, and so thank you guys. But we're going to go to the Lord in prayer, and I've asked Brother Ken if he would just take the needs of the Lord in prayer.
Let us pray. Heavenly Father, Lord Jesus, we thank you for this glorious day that you've given to us, Lord. Lord, we thank you for the opportunity to come to your house and worship you. And Lord, we just pray that from above you will reach your hand down and touch these sick people, Lord. And you yourself know their ailments, Lord, and you can bring them back to their healthy life. Lord, we breathe in prayer, and we know that our prayers will be answered. And Lord, we know that you'll pour out all your blessings that you can on these people, Lord, especially our pastor and his wife, Lord. We just pray that you'll lift them up and get them back to us. Our part of our family's got a hole in it without them being here. And Lord, we count on you for all your blessings. Lord, we pray for this country that you can get us on the back right track, Lord, and just get away from this COVID and this flu and all this ailments that's going through the air, Lord. It's really wrecking the country. Lord, we pray for these schools and these kids. They're so messed up in these things. They don't have no idea which way to turn anymore, Lord. And we know we put them in your hands and you will take care of them. Lord, we pray that you be with this congregation today and be with the minister today as he brings the message that we can take something with us, Lord, that we have learned more about you. Lord, we ask these things in your precious and holy name. Amen.
Some reason I have this just keep rolling through my head, this faith, and we talked about it in Sunday school, faith over fear, freedom over fear. I choose to live my life in faith and trusting in the one who is in charge of everything. You know what? I'm looking out here, and I said something in Sunday school this morning that I just thought was a given. I thought everybody understood it. I thought it was an understood term. Attaboy. Has anybody ever heard the word, the term, the phrase attaboy? Okay. How many like to receive the phrase, term, attaboy? All right. We like an attaboy every once in a while. We like a pat on the back. And how that came about. I'm strange. I'm weird. I know it. But it's okay. Proud of you. Okay. I received a phone call earlier this week, and I was told proud of you. It's three little words. It doesn't mean much. Or does it? When you hear those words, just for no real reason whatsoever, you're just doing what you do. You just are doing your job. You're taking care of your home. You're raising your family. And somebody looks at you and says, proud of you. Attaboy. Good job. It means something. So if you have the opportunity to give somebody an attaboy, I'm proud of you. I'm proud of you, son. I'm proud of you, daughter. Mom, dad, I'm proud of you. Mom, dad, I'm proud of you. If you have that opportunity, don't shuck it off. Don't kick it to the side. Do it. If you're a boss and you have that opportunity to share with your coworkers, you're an attaboy, I'm proud of you, do it. That's my little 2 cents for today. Okay? An attaboy. An attaboy. Or an attagirl. All right. So, attaboy. All right. We are getting ready to go into worship. And we're getting ready to give of our tithes and our offerings. And you know what? Our Heavenly Father wants to give you an attaboy. All right? How many want to receive an attaboy from our Heavenly Father? Amen. I hope we all do. Okay? He wants you to do your job. And when you do your job and you think it doesn't, it's not seen, it's kind of overlooked, realize that if nobody else sees it, your Heavenly Father sees it, the one who matters the most. Okay. So we're getting ready to give our tithes and our offerings. Okay. God is blessing you. Let's give back to the church. Okay. Give of your tithes, give of your offerings. We've got the baskets here on the altar. We got one in the middle that you can give in. If you want to mail it in, please mail it in. Or you can do it electronically via the Venmo app. And we appreciate all those that are out there in internet land. Okay, whether you're from coast to coast or north to south, wherever you're sending your money from, or whether you're viewing us online, we appreciate you for doing that and continue to do so. Thank you, guys. So, but as we get into worship, okay, the worship team may be down just a little bit. Mom's not here this morning, okay? But you know what? It doesn't take one. It takes you all, because we're giving God our worship. Okay, we may have some leaders up here that are leading us, and last week I was chopped liver because I was kind of overlooked. For those that are viewing online, you don't remember, go back to last week, okay? But I appreciate everybody that is up here, and attaboy, attagirl, everybody up here. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Let's give our tithes and offerings. Let's give God our worship. Heavenly Father, Lord, we love you. God, we want to say first and foremost, thank you, Lord, that we have the abilities, Lord, we have the freedoms that we have in this great country of ours to serve you, to worship you, to be in this house, to be in your presence. God, we just ask, Lord, that as we come and we give of our tithes and our offerings, Lord, you receive that. Lord, we just ask that, Lord, you receive our worship, Lord, and it just glorify you and it lift you up, Lord. It will bring us out of our situations, problems, Lord, when we give it to you. God, we just ask, Lord, you have your hand upon this service this morning. Lord, you bless our ministers, Lord, that you would just give them your power in them, Lord. And we love you and we thank you. In your name we pray. Amen.
Please stand if you're able to.
Open my eyes, let me see. saw your tabernacle. Glory to the Lord on high, God of wonders beyond our galaxy. You are holy, holy. The universe declares your majesty. You are holy, holy. Lord of heaven and earth. Lord of heaven and earth. Early in the morning, I will celebrate the light as I stumble in the darkness. I will call your name by night, God of wonders beyond our galaxy. You are holy, holy.
I have a home prepared where the saints abide, just over in that glory land. And I long to be by my Savior's side, just over in that glory land. Well, just over in I'll stand just over in the glory. fast, just over in that glory land. There to sing God praise and glory share, just over in that glory land. Well, just over in that glory land. The mighty host I'll stand just over in that glory land. Well, with that blood war song, I'll shout and sing just over in that glory. Man, Hosanna, that's the Lord and King, just over in that glory. Well, just over in that glory land, there with the happy angel band, just over in that glory land, just over in that glory land, there with the mighty host I'll stand, just over. Well, you may look for me out there. I'll be there. I'll be there. Well, you may look for me, but I'll be there. Glory to His name.
Amen, amen. You may be seated. Thank you, praise team. Great job. See if I can get this thing to turn on. Brother Michael told me how to do it. I think I got it. We've got some special people here this morning. Brother and Sister McGee have traveled long distances to be here with you this morning. I'm probably not on the screen, but it'll be okay. Here I am again. And we do appreciate them for coming this morning to deliver God's word to His people, okay, to you guys. And so I want to invite the McGees up, Brother and Sister McGee. And maybe they've got a song. Maybe Brother McGee is going to get on the drums. I don't know. Maybe Sister McGee is. But I will turn them over to them.
God bless you folks this morning. Where'd the piano player going? Where'd she go? I was going to sing, Had It Not Been, you know that song, in A? But it's good to feel the presence of the Lord. Aren't you glad that you're on the hallelujah side? No matter what sickness comes, no matter what happens to us, we're still on the hallelujah side. And we are just over in the glory land, not very far away. We're going to be able to rejoice with the Lord. And we'll leave all this behind. And I'm thankful that we've got something to look forward to, for that is our hope. Our hope is in Christ Jesus. And thank God for those that are still here today and that are able to be in the house of the Lord. And because we're here, we need to rejoice. Rejoice in the Lord. And I was thinking of this song, Had It Not Been. And we came through Christmas, and we saw how Jesus came as a babe. But I began to think, just suppose God had searched all through heaven, and He couldn't find one willing to be the supreme sacrifice that was needed to buy eternal life for you and me. It could have been that way, you know, but God had a plan, and it was a good plan, and it included you, and it included me, and He searched us, and He sought us out, And I'm so thankful that he did. I wanted to say that we do already have our ladies retreat on the calendar, September the 15th through the 17th. And this year, it's going to be at Fenton, the church in Fenton, Brother and Sister Rhodes Church. And we do have a speaker, a little gal that came and spoke several years ago. We watched her grow up in one of our churches in Oregon when we were up there. Katie Kaufman, of course her name's not Kaufman now, but the Lord uses her mightily and she's consented to come. She took a few years off. She got married and then she had two babies. And I believe and I respect the fact that she realized that her first ministry was to her family. So she didn't go out and speak around while she was there. I don't know for sure how old the kids are now. Like, they're not very old, like 4 maybe and 5. But she's now going to branch out and speak, and she's coming to speak for us. And so be in prayer about that. And if you haven't got your vacation or you don't have it on your calendar yet, September the 15th through the 17th in Fenton, Missouri. So be planning on that. We'd love to have you come and go be with us. Our theme this year is chosen. Aren't you glad that he chose us? He didn't choose us because that we had great intelligence, but he chose us that we might go forth and bring forth fruit, and that our fruit should remain. And he chose us on purpose for a purpose. Every one of us here today has a purpose, and we've been chosen by God. And so let's just remember that, be in prayer for our ladies' conference. And we do have coming up in March is our Link Conference, and possibly Brother McGee will say more something about that. It's going to be in Jefferson City at Solid Rock Family Church. So if you can get away and come to that, we invite you to come. I think it's March 10th and 11th. And so we're just going about having a good time in the Lord. And the Bible said that Jesus went about doing good. So we need to follow his example and go about doing good as we're in our daily lives and as we're working for him. Let's do good for Jesus Christ. Listen to words of this song. Just suppose. Is that A? A. Let's try. That seems a little high. Let's do D, maybe. Just suppose God had searched through heaven and could not find one willing to be the supreme sacrifice that was needed to my eternal life for you and me. That's still a little high, I think. Just suppose God had searched through heaven and could not find one willing About Jesus and how he died on the cross, then we begin to think, who am I? Who am I that he died on that cross for me? But he loves you and he loves me. When I think of how he came so far from glory, give him praise. Praise you, Jesus.
Amen. I'll tell you what, it's a wonderful thing to be in God's house, isn't it?
Amen.
Amen. And you woke up feeling good. I liked what Jeremy was saying. We woke up, we're breathing, we're feeling good. Amen. How many feels good in the Lord?
Amen.
Amen. He never fails us, does he? Well, it is a joy to be here at Versailles and to fill in for your pastors, Brother and Sister Owsley, very precious friends of ours and faithful ministers through many years. And can tell you this, people of that caliber, Brother and Sister Owsley, your pastors are not here, but that caliber don't come along every day. You need to be thankful for what you have. You know, I've been a bishop, I used to call us superintendents, and then somebody out of Canada came to our convention and told us we need to be bishops, doing the same thing. So I've been superintendent for many years in the Northwest, and now they call us bishops, so I'm learning how to bish. But the same thing, under all of that, I'm the same guy. And I've seen a lot of ministers down through the years, and you have to go some to beat the pastor that you have. You are truly blessed with some of the best, as far as I'm concerned today. And it was a joy to meet our brother evangelist that's here visiting today, him and his wife. Amen. And we had a good conversation there, visiting with him. You know, when you belong to the kingdom of God, that's a good feeling. We got brothers and sisters we haven't met yet. But I'm kind of used to that. My wife, when I married her in 1969, is from a family of 12 kids. We've been married 52 years, and I'm still meeting relatives. You know, so that's just the way it is. You know, I mean, he's never been there and done that. But anyway, Brother Owsley, he was under the weather, not feeling good, and we've been praying for them, and gave me a call. So I called our other pastor I was going to be with today and told him that Brother Owsley wasn't feeling good. I need to go there. And so we just switched Sundays. I'll be back over at the other place the following Sunday. But we always enjoy being here with you folks. Wherever God's people is, that's my crowd. Amen. I appreciate that. And so God has certainly been a good God. Appreciate my wife. Appreciate her traveling with me, helping me out, telling me how to drive, where to turn, all these things. Amen. We appreciate our spouse, don't we? Amen. Appreciate them and what they're doing. Well, the one thing I want to tell you today is I'm going to be preaching about five steps to staying focused on God. How many believe you can do that? You can stay focused on God. Now, Jeremy didn't have his glasses up here. He wasn't focused in. But on a spiritual note, we can be focused on God. And it's very important that we are, especially this day. We see a lot of things happening in our world today we've never seen before. We're experiencing things we've never experienced before, like COVID and this disease. But when I read the scripture, the next big event out of the Bible is the appearing of Christ, the church being taken out. Boom, we're gone. So some things have to happen, but people are searching for answers. People are searching for something they can depend on, some kind of foundation. And there's people today looking and doing everything they can to have hope. And I'm telling you that in Jesus Christ, we have hope. And so who has the answer today? People are discouraged with the politics out of Washington and different things, wondering who to believe in, what to believe in, and which direction is our country going. I was talking to one of our pastors that had dinner with the governor here about a month or so ago. The governor wanted to meet with 10 pastors from different walks of faith, and he was there, and the governor was talking about how that he was thankful for the prayers. And here in Missouri, we went from about 1,500 to 1,700 abortions down to 50 now. And he said, keep praying for us. We're doing what we can, you know, for that. Roe versus Wade is 49 years old today. And they're going to discuss that. But I was talking with that pastor and others, and we're doing our best to set down dinner with the governor of Missouri. Get all of our ministers there. Don't have to be a pastor, just some ministers. Get us all there and see what we can do to help our state become more godly and more like God. And let them know there's no problem bigger than God. And then let them know there's still joy in the Lord. If you don't have nothing to be happy about, you can be happy in Jesus Christ. Amen? So we have the answers. You know, and I'm either a getting up guy, you know, up or getting up. I was telling my new friend there, I'm either up or getting up. I've been saying that for years. Sometimes it takes all day, all week, all month, all year, but in the Lord, I'm going to get up. Amen. I've always said that. So God needs us today because you know why? There have many committees in Washington and every state. They have people that are supposed to be very smart, intelligent people trying to make decisions of what's going to help our country. But I want you to know who has the answers to what's going to help us. It's you and I. And where's it at? We need to tell them the answers we need are in this book. Amen. Everything we need is right here to help us to be more than overcomers in Jesus Christ. I want you to stand this morning, if you would. I want everybody to do something a little different. I hadn't done this in a while. But I'm going to show you something. I want you to hold your hands out like this. Now, don't slap your neighbor. Just move out in the aisle if you have to. Everybody, all the way across, hold your hands out like this. I'm going to give you an exercise. Got your hands out there? All right. I'm going to count to three. And when I say clap, I want you to clap, okay? Everybody ready to do it? Get your hands out. Ready? One, two, three. Clap. What happened there? Sit down, I'll tell you what happened. You know what happened? All of you guys did what you saw me do, not what I told you to do. In other words, I'm trying to tell you, if you stay focused on God, your life will speak more volumes than what you say. What you have in you. You know, we've got the Lord in us. I still have the Lord in me when somebody pulls in front of me. By the time I get done saying what I feel, my wife's all over me. I just say, they've got to repent. You know, not me. They got to repent. You know, getting out there driving like that. No, but the thing is, we have the answers. Now, what I'm going to give you on these five steps of staying focused on God is this. It'll help us in this day because we have to discipline ourselves. It's kind of like this. If you want prayer and the pastor says, I want you to come to the front. We're going to anoint you and we're going to pray for you. All right, the invitation is given. Now the responsibility is on you. You've got to come to the front if you want to be prayed for. But then after we anoint you and we pray for you, then it's not up to us. It's up to God. But also he said what? As your faith is, so be it unto who? You. So we stand on his word. And that's what we do. We never give up. We stay focused on God. I'm going to read out of the book of John in that 15th chapter, the first 11 verses. And I may have to focus. Jeremy, I forgot my glasses this morning. So I might. Amen. So if you're in the book of John, how many likes the book of John? Let me tell you about the Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. How many knows what synoptic Gospels are? The synoptic Gospels are Matthew, Mark, and Luke. See, Matthew was written to the Jew. And the Jews always made sacrifice for the Lord. And so in the book of Matthew, when you read it, you find that they're presenting Christ as a perfect sacrifice. Mark was written to the Romans. The Romans were in rule at that time. So when Mark presented the gospel, he presented the gospel as a perfect servant. Because a Roman could come up and tell somebody to take up their things and walk a mile. And Jesus comes along and said, no, walk two. So a perfect servant. So I'm showing you here how God reaches every culture. And then Luke was written to the Greeks. Because the Greeks are all about the body, the physique, how strong it is. And so what they do, they presented Christ as a perfect man. So when you look at that, that's called the Synoptic Gospels. But then we go to the book of John, and the book of John was written to the world. Whosoever, you know, he's saying, whosoever shall repent, whosoever call upon the Lord shall be saved. You know, and so we're in the book that's going all the way around the world. It's to anybody. And here's what he said. And I like this. He said, I am the vine, and my Father. Can I borrow your glasses, hon? My wife, come up here and read this. This is the first time in 52 years of ministry I've asked my wife to read. I don't know if I trust her or not, because then she's going to want to exhort and want to do this and want to do that. Okay. The first 11 verses.
I am the true vine, and my Father is the husbandman. Every branch in me that beareth not fruit, he taketh away. And every branch that beareth fruit, he purgeth it, that it may bring forth more fruit. Now ye are clean through the word which I have spoken unto you. Abide in me, and I in you, as the branch cannot bear fruit of itself, except it abide in the vine. No more can ye, except ye abide in me. I am the vine, ye are the branches. He that abideth in me, and I in him, the same bringeth forth much fruit. For without me ye can do nothing. If a man abide not in me, he is cast forth as a branch, and is withered. And men gather them, and cast them into the fire, and they are burned. If ye abide in me, and my words abide in you, ye shall ask what ye will, and it shall be done unto you. Herein is my Father glorified, that ye bear much fruit, so shall ye be my disciples. As the Father hath loved me, so have I loved you. Continue ye in my love. If ye keep my commandments, ye shall abide in my love, even as I have kept my Father's commandments and abide in his love. These things have I spoken unto you, that my joy might remain in you, and that your joy might be full.
Thank you, hon. The thing about it is, what I wanted to do today is, of course, many of you probably have read that scripture many times, but the key is abiding. How do you stay focused? We have to abide in the Lord. Now, up here, you'll notice that it says, there are only the pursued and the pursuing and the busy and the tired. I'd probably say that covers about all of us. Wouldn't you say that? And you may think that that's an old, old thing to say. But that come out of a book called The Great Gatsby, and that was written in 1925. I want you to know something. The Word of God is not old. It's always been there, and it's always been fresh, and it's always a cutting edge. And David said, a lamp unto my feet and a light in my path. And I want you to know there's a lot of things that have been said and done concerning this. And so when you look at that and you see that people's lives today are hurried and they're distracted, and it gets hectic, because it just seems like there's not enough hours in a day. Sometimes when we have projects and things, we wonder if we're going to get it all done. And so all of this has happened. But I put something down. I was in my office last night about midnight when your pastor had called me that day, and I had a lot of things going yesterday, but God laid something on my heart for you today. So I typed it out so I could remember. Said, still, when you look at all of these things, and you see the people of the 1920s, their lives were hurried, distracted, and chaotic, just like our lives are right now. Every generation has the same type issues. And so when you look at that, you'll find there's never been as many distractions in the life of a person as what we have now. You look at your cell phone, and when you see that cell phone, and you look at it, and I think, well, I've got my cell phone here, but really it's just not a phone, is it? It's a whole lot more than a phone. It's a GPS if I need it. Gives me the weather report if I need it. I can text somebody if I want to. It's actually a mini computer. And cell phones today rule a lot of people's lives. A lot of churches I'm in, they have up on the board, please turn off your cell phones. You know why they want you to do that? It's because they want you to stay focused. When I was pastoring several years ago, we had a good-sized church, and God was good to us. It was packed that day. And I was preaching an illustrated message, and while I was preaching in that message, I had it set up that my wife would call our youth pastor. So they called him halfway through my message, and the phone's ringing and ringing, and I'm trying to preach. And it's ringing and ringing and ringing. And finally, I put the mic down. And he says, "Hello?" Everybody heard it. He says, "Hello?" And when he says that, I'm real quiet, and I turn and I'm looking at him. "Yeah? Well, he's preaching right now. Well, couldn't you call him back after service? You need to talk to him right now?" And finally, I lift the microphone up. This is what I did in our church. I said, "Who is that, Eric?" He said, "That's, you got a call for you, and they just want to talk to you." I said, "Right now?" They said, "Yeah, right now." I said, "Well, bring me the phone." And they brought me the phone. I put the mic down. I go, "Hello? Yeah. No, I'm right in the middle of a message." And I heard out in the congregation, "My stars. I can't believe somebody would do that. Why would they do that?" Or whatever. But I had the attention of the entire congregation. I had the attention of everybody on the platform. And finally, I put my cell phone in my pocket. And I said, "If everybody was as interested in what God had to say through this message as they are what they see on their cell phone, I'll guarantee you, you'll be focused on God." Because I've had them get their cell phones and run out and do different things. The only guy excuse is, well, we had the chief cardiologist in our church from time to time, and he'd have to go. But you know what? It just seems like they have to say, they can't put it aside. I remember when Walmart closed for Christmas in our town. I think some people thought our town just right then just blew apart. They were just so disgusted. They couldn't make it 24 hours until it opened up after Christmas. So where is your focus today? Is it on certain programs on television? I tell you what, I'm going to tell you something I believe today. And God, I haven't put the message yet together. But everybody is vying for your time. They want your attention. If they can't get it on a billboard, they're going to send you advertisements. You get the newspaper, there's advertisements. You turn your television set on, you're going to watch a movie. You get 5 minutes of the movie, 10 minutes of commercials. You'll find that everywhere you go, there's signs and sales and everything. Everybody wants to get the attention of people today. Why? To make you feel better. To make you buy their product. To make you feel like you're going to be an individual that is satisfied. I'm telling you here today, there's nothing in this world that satisfies like Jesus does. If you'll abide in Him, He'll abide in you. He'll be with you in the store. He'll be with you in your car. He'll be with you at home. He'll be there with you while you're sleeping. But in the Word of God, God will not abandon us. He's there. Give Him a hand of appreciation for that. So everybody's competing for our attention. But I want to tell you something. When you look at the Bible and you see it, there's one thing that He says in the Bible more than anything else. One thing He says that He wants us to be is He wants us to abide in Him. And Him abide in us. How do we do that? The first thing I want to put up there is we begin with God. There's five things, five steps. Number one, we've got to begin with God. There you go. Begin with God. You know, and the thing is, if you begin the day with Him, you have to start with Him. These are the five things. A lot of times if up there for the guy doing my PowerPoint, if you just hit your arrow down, it'll shoot one of them out. Do you have that? Oh, do you have that? Don't have that. That's okay. I was going to give it to you easy. Now you're getting the whole load right there. You begin the day with God. Now, I've drawn some other things down. Said, I know it sounds simple enough, and it's going to be one of the first suggestions you'll find in any article like this. But it's for good reason. Here's what I wrote down. If you or I are going to stay focused on God, we've got to include the things of God in our daily life. His things have got to be in our daily life. You know, when I travel, my mind's on God. Matter of fact, when I'm traveling and I'm driving, and my mind thinks over the ministry, what I'm doing here. How many does that? All of a sudden you're alone, and all of a sudden you stopped. All of a sudden you can focus, and you're thinking on the things you have. Well, if we're going to be an individual that stays focused on God, we've got to begin that day with the Lord. And so here's this. You've ever heard somebody that tells you when you read in the Bible and it's repeated twice, two or three times, that is something that's very important. You better get a hold of it. And when you look at that, you'll find the word of abide and the word remain is in the Bible more than anything else. He wants us in his word. He said, study to show yourselves approved unto God. He didn't say men. But as you get in the word gets inside of you. There's no way you can get the word inside of you and it doesn't excite you. It doesn't let you know, hey, I know that I know that I know. God is on the throne. Our country's going off in a different direction. People are trying to justify a living that is totally anti-God, trying to justify sin. But I'm here to tell you, God's still on the throne. God's still in control. Nothing can happen unless he permits it. But God has a remnant of people that's living right now, this day, that are abiding in him. And I'll stand up and say, yes, there's a God in heaven. You say you can't have him say anything about God in school? Oh, yes, you can. I'll talk about God regardless of where I am because that's who I am. It's Jesus Christ and his word inside of me. That's who we are. I have two girls in their 40s doing real good. And my oldest daughter decided she wanted to get out of office work. And so she took her real estate license in San Antonio. My kids are all from there. And so she passed on the first time. She got her cards made. And when she got a card made, she had a scripture put on the back of that card. And they called her in, the broker did. It's a pretty good sized real estate agency. And they called her in and said, Rhonda, said, you probably ought to take that scripture off there. That's going to stop you from getting listings. People don't like that on there. She said, well, I'm sorry. That's who I am. It's got to be there. And I'm leaving it on there. He said, that's your choice. She left it on there. And all of a sudden, she got all these listings, didn't she? And they're looking at it and said, wow, Rhonda, you've done better than anybody that's ever started with us. I'm here to tell you, with God, he directs your path. Yes. He opens the doors that are closed. He opens them up for us today. Here, Jesus said, abide in me. He repeated it in two other ways where he said that he wanted us to abide and remain in him. He said, for whosoever abides in me and I in him, he that bears much fruit. Wow. How many's ever planted a garden? You went out there and there's the good part and there's the little scrawny things over here. Well, you know, the thing about it is, he said, if we abide in him and I in him, he that bears much fruit from apart from doing nothing, if anyone does not abide in me, he is thrown away like a branch, and the branches are gathered, thrown in the fire, and burned. So if you abide in my words in you, ask what you wish, and it'll be done unto you. Now, what he's saying here, if you'll stay in him, everything's going to work out. Now, I've been in administrative work in the ministry full-time about 25 years. And didn't know I was going this route. It just so happens it's that way. But I can truly tell you, in all the years of our ministry, we've only told God what our needs were, and the needs came in. He brings it in abundantly. He takes care of us in ways I didn't even know he took care of us. You know, I had a guy, I needed a car years ago. How many has ever needed a car? Another one that'll run and do good things. And we were praying about that. And my car blew up and broke down. I had to leave it alongside the freeway in Oregon. I was on my way to a meeting in Southern Oregon. I was a keynote speaker there for a lot of churches. But my wife and baby stayed in the car, and I hitchhiked. And I got in town and got back, and we had our car towed. Some friends of mine came back, and we towed our car there in Grants Pass, Oregon, over to a place called Engine Rebuilders. He went in there and said, it's shot. We've got to rebuild the engine. I said, well, it has to be fixed. He said, okay. And one of the pastors in Southern Oregon loaned me his car. Brand new Oldsmobile. I'm going, wow, I've never had anything like this. Man, I loved it. I was hoping they never fixed that car. You know, I could use his car, you know. But anyway, after about 6 weeks, I get a call from Grants Pass, Oregon, and they said, I want you to know your car's all ready. I want you to come and get it. I said, okay. And my wife said, how are you going to pay for it? I said, I don't know. I said, all I'm going to do is go tell him where it's at. I don't have it now. You have to keep the car till I get the money. It was more than what I had. But I remember when I went into full-time ministry, I said, God, don't ever let me be a beggar, and don't ever let me feel alone. But when I walked in, I made up my mind. I drove up there, and I walked in there. And he said, hey, I've been waiting on you, Reverend. I said, yeah, I got something I want to tell you. He said, oh, I got something I want to tell you. He said, here's the keys. I said, well, I started to tell him I didn't have the money paid. And he said, somebody walked in here, bill's all paid. It's all yours. Do you ever see a preacher without words? Hello. Got in the car. My wife took the other car, and we took it back, and we had our car. What I'm here to tell you is he supplies your needs. Say, if you go to God and you abide in him, sometimes people wonder if they're going to make it. You know, you go to the store, some of the items may not be there. That doesn't matter. God's storehouse is full. He still knows how to take care of his people, and he's going to take care of you. So staying on focus requires abiding in him. You know, I know your mornings, I wrote this down, are rushed. But if you create the discipline to spend time the first few minutes of your day reading his word and talking to him about the day and that day that you're facing, you'll have a greater focus on him throughout that day. So most Christians I know, they say, God help me. Or somebody, maybe you just missed having an accident. Thank the Lord, his hand was on it. You know, we give him glory. Our conversation is different. Why? Because we're abiding in God. Second thing, I'm not going to keep you way past lunchtime, but we have to remain in prayer. You know, you want to create and develop the habit of a prayerful life. 1 Thessalonians 5:17 makes one simple yet bold command. He said, pray without ceasing. So every day we pray. I pray every day. I walk and pray. I can be sitting someplace and pray. I try not to be too mean about this message. I thought somebody turned me off. I'm either up or getting up. Remember that. But you see, when you pray, I feel the presence of God. Yes. And there's times I never felt his presence. Some of us have situations we have to deal with. We have to rely upon God. You know, I would pray a long time. My friend of mine, Dr. George, the chief cardiologist for the hospital, he said, and I've known him for years, and his oldest son was getting married, and he wanted me to be sure and be at that wedding. And the wedding was in New York City. So I said, well, I said, I'll try. And we put it down, and he kept asking us for months if we were going to be there. So it came the day to fly out to be there for that wedding because I respected him and his family. And so I went in the house and I got my briefcase, my Bible, everything, and I'm headed to the car. My wife yells, hey, grab this, will you? And I set my briefcase down, went and got it, and got in the car. And we got almost to the airport, and I said, is my briefcase back there? She says, no. I said, oh, no. Because, you see, I left it at the house. But they had scheduled me to preach at a church in New York. Never been there before. So we get there, and they pick us up at the airport, and there's people flying in from all over the country, all over the world, for this wedding. They knew people everywhere. And so we get there, and then they have all these activities going on. And so I get there on a Friday, all day Saturday, all these activities. There's about 1,000 people that shows up. So they're all there, and we go on these buses, and they take us to these banquet rooms, place, that's all they have. So they take us in one, and they got these food stations all throughout there, different kinds of food, and we're to walk around and eat a little bit and visit with everybody. I said, man, I can handle this. God is in this trip, you know, I'm enjoying that. And after about an hour, hour and a half visiting with everybody, they run us all out of there, said, it's time for the banquet. I said, banquet? We've been eating for an hour and a half. And we go into the banquet room, and we're sitting there, and everybody sits down to a dinner, which we didn't have any room to eat. But then they brought the dessert around. My wife said, I can't eat a thing. Well, when they brought that dessert tray, she said, I think I can make room for that right there. So her and I had dessert. So by the time I got back to the hotel room, it was really late. And I said, I'll use a Gideon Bible. I'm supposed to preach in the morning. So we looked in all the drawers and everything. There wasn't one. She said, I'll go down and get one at the office. My wife went down at the office and said, could we have a Gideon Bible? My husband needs one tonight. They said, well, we don't have Bibles in the room. She said, you don't? He said, no, we don't do that here. I said, well, they do it in Missouri. I said, well, we don't have a Bible. She comes back up and she says, they don't have any Bibles. And I'm going to preach the next morning. And here's after midnight, and I'm exhausted. So I said, well, okay, I'm going to get up at 4, honey, and I'm going to try to study. And I said, I'll just have to use my cell phone. So I got up at 4 o'clock, used my cell phone. God put something in my heart, and I went down to the office and got a sheet of paper, kind of like this, and folded it in half, and I wrote some scripture down. So the next morning, they took us over to this church, huge church, and full of people, over 1,000 people in that church that morning. And here comes an usher with white gloves, and looks like a tux. Bishop, do you have your PowerPoint, sir? I said, all I have is just this piece of paper, and gave that to him. So I walked in, and they said, we want you to sit on the platform. They had a place for me. Said, we got other pastors there. Well, there were pastors there from Australia, Europe, America, everywhere. Sitting up there, and we were facing the pulpit, so they had a place for me. And so they set me down, and I'm thinking, oh my, I'm supposed to preach this morning. And so I got to talking, and they introduced me to all those pastors, and I'm sitting next to the chaplain for the Queen of England. And I said, okay. So I'm sitting with this guy. And if you're a minister, you're wondering, okay, what am I going to say these guys don't already know? Everybody been in a situation like that? So I sat there and I just prayed, and when they turned the service to me, I got up out of the chair, and when I did, I started the pulpit. 1, 2, 3, pow! I feel the anointing of God come all over me. I walk up there and I had the liberty that I needed to be able to preach what God put in my heart. You see, I always told God, I don't want to be a beggar, but I don't want to feel alone either. I'm here to tell you, I don't care what situation you are in, you are not alone. God is with you. When we lost our son, he was only 21 months old in 1972. I was not alone when I was praying that prayer. I've never been alone with God because he is there with you and he abides in you. But I like talking to him, and that's why he says to us that he wants us to remain in prayer. You know what? He doesn't want some kind of simple prayer with the these and the thous and all of that other. He wants your heart. And when you pray from your heart, that's what he listens to today. Third thing, you got to limit your distractions. There's a lot of distractions out there, you know, that comes up. You know, Israel, when they were following Joshua and they were on their way to the promised land, what was happening there? Now, you have to stay focused on God. God told them to take the ark and put it about a half mile in front of them. You know why God did that? You know, now they were in one place. God takes Moses, and he takes Moses up and he buries him. Joshua, the mantle's on you. When you see the ark move, that's when you want to move. He told Joshua, he said, get the ark. The ark at that time was right in the middle of all the Israeli tribes. He said, take it out of the middle of the tribes and go out there about a half mile and put it out there. You guys stay back here. You know why he did that? He wanted them to stay focused on the ark, God's presence in the ark. When you see it move, you move. What you do is you limit your distractions. There's a lot of things that can get your mind off of God. A lot of things that get your mind off of God's blessings. But I'm here to tell you, the blessings of God are just as full as they always were. God's power to heal is just as powerful to do that. God's power to give you peace of mind is just as powerful to do that. There's two times in my ministry I had like a cloak come down over me. When I was hurting so bad, one night is when my son died. I tried to save him, couldn't save him. I was in a little country church. I told God I hurt so bad. All of a sudden, it was like a cloak from heaven came warm and wrapped around me. And all of a sudden, I had this peace. My heart settled down. My blood pressure went down. I had peace of mind. Why? Because God was there. I want you to know there's a lot of people that laid down their life. And in their last breath, they had peace. Why? God was there. I'm here to tell you, in the last hours and the last moments of your life, God is there. If God has taken some by COVID, they just stepped into eternity in a brand new place that is absolutely perfect with no diseases there. But while we're here, let's walk in Him. Let's not get distracted. And let's do all we can to be fulfilling His purpose in our life. Fourth thing is serve God. Boy, a lot of people want God, but don't ask anything of me. You know, I don't want to do anything. You know, I find myself sometimes years ago, and I do it every now and then, God, I want you to comfort the afflicted and afflict the comfortable. Right. Why? It needs to stir us up a little bit. Yes. Yes. Just kind of like the old eagle in his nest. He's got briars and everything, but he makes it nice and has the little eaglets, and they're there, and they've got to learn to fly. Their purpose is not to stay in the nest. You know, and so all of a sudden, he'll take them out, and they'll drop them, they'll flutter around, then he'll grab them back, take them back up there, keep it up until pretty soon they have a greater principle than God's law of gravity, because gravity will pull you down. God also has a law of aerodynamics. When they spread those wings, all of a sudden they learn how to control it. They're soaring above all the death below them and all the things that are below us. I'm here to tell you, I read about great men of God, still see great men of God today. And I want you to know that God's still got his hand on them, and we can soar. When we serve God, he'll lift us up and he'll help us to accomplish what he's called us to do. I remember reading an article years ago that in the early church, Andrew Jackson came to church, and he sat there in the church. Some of the elders of that church came to the pastor. Pastor, you better be careful, said Andrew Jackson is here. Watch what you're saying this morning. He said, I'm going to say what God told me to say. He may be a great general and done all those things, but Andrew Jackson needs the Lord just as much as you need the Lord and everyone else. He needs the message that comes from God. You see, I don't have the power to do things, but God's Word does. It breaks every binding chain. It lifts us up. It puts our feet on solid ground. And I've known people today that have been in high positions that God saved them. And I've also known those that couldn't even read that had the power of God come over them and do wonderful things in them. Because when we serve God, we'll see results. I'm going to ask the piano player and musicians to come if they would this morning. Years ago, I was in a service with a friend of mine in Southern Oregon, and they had a deaf ministry in their church. They had several people that were deaf. And they had a teenage girl that couldn't talk, couldn't hear. And I preached a message there, and then we had an altar call, and she came down with everybody else to pray. And they prayed with her. They were doing sign language, and then they just started praying. And the little girl had her head bowed. She was a teenager. And all of a sudden, she started speaking her first words. The words that she was speaking in tongues. And she was speaking in tongues there for about 2 or 3 minutes, and they told me all of a sudden she's not speaking in tongues, and she's saying, "Hallelujah, praise God, I love you, Jesus." They never heard their daughter say anything. The first words they hear is say, "Praise God, I love you, Jesus. My life is yours, Christ." I'm telling you, God can do anything with these bodies. He can loose that deaf spirit. He can loose any kind of thing that's got a grip on you. But the one thing I know, whether I live or whether I die, I'm going to abide in Him.
Amen.
Because when I die, don't come looking for me in the grave. You're going to see an old decayed body. And I'll guarantee you, deodorant ain't working there. It's decaying. But then you've got to do the last thing and remove that sin from your life. These are the 5 steps if you're going to focus on Him. In other words, God has to help us love the unloved. Do you ever get somebody in your life, you just, if you could do what you wanted to do, it wasn't nice. You know, we have to get sin out of our life. That means if God tells us to tithe, you've got to tithe. If God tells you to give in an offering, give in an offering. My wife and I have always been that way. If God told her to give so much, she did. And I never questioned it. And if I did, she never questioned it. Sometimes she'd get all we had. But you know what? God always gives it back to us abundantly. Because that's how God works. So in God's house, He needs you. He wants you to do these 5 things. And to get any kind of sin. Remove a habit in your life that God's not pleased with. Remove something that's a continually habit and a pattern in your life you know God's not pleased with. Get rid of it. You know, when I stay in hotels and motels, sometimes I'll turn on the TV station. They want to advertise certain channels that are X-rated channels. All you got to do is do it. Nobody will ever know that. You know, there's never been a desire for me to do that. It isn't that I could do it and nobody would know it. God would. But it's that's not who I am. I am in Jesus Christ. I don't do that. When you're on your television set and something comes up that is just absolutely filthy, you have the power to turn the channel. When you go to Walmart, I know they got a lot of booze they sell in Walmart, but I don't buy the booze. You see, when I'm someplace else, I don't do those things, but I represent Jesus Christ wherever I'm at. God will use you in a powerful way. Could we stand together today? It's kind of like running a marathon. You know, He said to kill the sin or it's going to spiritually kill us, physically and spiritually, both. But it's been said this countless times, life is like a marathon, not a sprint. When staying focused on God, it becomes really evident, especially. Hebrews 12:1 tells us this. We must run the race that lies ahead of us and never give up. But the next verse comes up and it tells us how to do it. He said we must focus on Jesus, the source and goal of our faith. Taking these 5 steps in our daily life is going to deepen your spiritual walk with the Lord and draw you ever closer to Him. How many wants to be deeper in God? I've had people attack me because I'm a minister, not physically, but verbally. There's challenges out there, but deep down inside, people will know if you've got what it takes to stand and boldly stand for the Lord Jesus Christ. I stand for the Lord, but also stand for that flag. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Give the Lord a good hand for that flag. But that flag is there. Is there a Christian flag? There it is. That's because that flag is there. This nation was established of men and women praying and seeking God. Amen. So I'm an American. Amen. I'm a veteran, a Vietnam veteran. My dad was a veteran. There's millions of veterans around. Some of you may not have served, but maybe you served in other ways. But now we're in the Lord's army. And let's put on the armor of God and be more than overcomers through Jesus Christ. I'd like every head bowed and every eye closed this morning. You can play if you'd like softly. Father, I just know that I've shared my heart with this congregation. You've been with us, Lord. Your power has been here. Your word is so true. I pray, God, that you'd look over the hearts of every individual represented. If there's any here that is not saved, I pray, God, that they'd make that decision, because I can't make it for them. Their mom or dad can't make it. Husband or wife can't make it. We all have to make that decision for ourselves. And if there's one here that's not born again, yet their life has been troubled, and they'd like to have the answers to joy and peace and strength and guidance and comfort, I pray that you would move upon their heart to give their life to you today. While heads are bowed, if you're here and you're not ready to meet Jesus, if he comes in a moment, in a twinkle of an eye, are you here? Would you slip your hand up while I wait just a moment? Anybody? We have one that's not ready to meet the Lord. We've got to be ready. Anyone else? If you're not ready to meet God, just let God see your hand. He knows your heart. Now what I'm going to do is I'm going to have them sing. And when they do, I'm going to ask you to come to the front. Sometimes we just need to come, get out of our comfort zone, and kneel before the Lord and call upon God. Remember your pastors in prayer. And remember these five things about staying focused on the Lord, our God. Let's sing and let's come to an altar.
There's room at the cross for you. There's room.
Come on, let's come and pray. All of us, let's find a place of prayer. Just before we dismiss, let's find a place.
Many have
oh, yes.
There's still room for one. Yes, yes, there's room at the cross for
you. Think about that. There's room at the cross for you. Sing it.
There's room.
Do we have some Christian women here today? We'll pray with our sister right here. Come on, if you're here, Christian ladies. Come on, we need somebody to help us.
Pray for you.
Oh, yes, hallelujah. Sing it.
Though millions have come, there's still room for one. Yes, there's room.
Sing it again, would you please?
There's room at the cross for you. There's room at the cross for you.
Oh yes, there's room there. Call upon him.
Oh, millions have come. There's still
oh, yes, Lord.
For one. Yes, there's room at the cross for
you. Oh, yes, there always is. Thank you, Lord.
There's room at the cross for you. There's room at the cross.
Just let him touch you today. Let the Lord touch you. Let his spirit touch you.
Have come, there's still room for one. Yes, there's room at that cross for you.
Oh, yes. Thank you,
there's
Jesus.
There's room at the cross for you.
Oh, yes, there is.
There's room at the cross for you.
Lift your hands and praise him this morning, would you? Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah.
Amen. Thank you, Brother McGee, Sister McGee. Aren't you glad that he left room for you? Christ came into this world in a place that, because there was no room. There was no room for him, so he had to go somewhere else. But he said, you know what? I'm going to open it up for everybody.
Yes.
And I'm going to hang on this cross for you. And he left room for us. Remember that. He left the room so we could step in. So we could step in till we receive him, and then we can take it out. And we can share it with each other. I want to thank the McGee's for coming this morning and delivering God's message to stay focused. A lot of times we get in life, and whether we have our glasses there or whatever, and we lose focus. We lose task. We lose sight of where we need to go. That last scripture that was put up there, never quit. I am a firm believer in never quit. You keep going. You keep stepping. You keep, you may get knocked down a little bit, but you know what? Get back up. Okay? I'm either getting up or I'm staying up, right? I'm up or getting up. Okay? We may get knocked down, but we're getting right back up. Okay? Because his arm is there. Thank the Lord that he opened the cross for us, that we can come to him. Thank you guys for coming out this morning. It's been a great morning, and it's going to be a great day. So take what you've got here and take it for the rest of the day. And don't just, well, Sunday night's over, Monday morning. Oh, it's just another Monday. Take it into Monday. And guess what? Into Tuesday. Do I need to keep going? We take it with us because he's giving it to us. All right, thank you guys. Remember, no service tonight, okay? Keep your pastors in a prayer, all those that were on the prayer request list, keep those in your prayer. Keep our country in your prayers, okay? No Thursday night service, no CFI. So, you guys remember. Thank you guys for coming tonight. I'm going to dismiss in prayer, and God bless. Dear Heavenly Father.